Now, nobody knew how long Captain Jim had been flying airplanes, not even him. They knew for sure that he'd started in the war, but which war he'd started in, they weren't really sure. But he'd flown DC-3s in the Second World War, and on the Berlin airlift, he'd flown a DC-4. He'd flown DC-6s and 7s and 8s, and everything Boeing pushed out of their gates. He'd flown beavers on skis and otters on floats, dropped water on fires from old flying boats, flown in the Arctic in the tropical climes, and circled the globe any number of times. But there was no flight that Jim liked to do half so well as a flight home to St. John's, and so it befell, that not long ago, on a fine winter's day, he departed Toronto, heading east for Torbay. Now, his co-pilot that day was a youngster named Tim, about 12 years old, with peach fuzz on his chin. He was only just hired. 'Twas his very first day. "Captain," he said, "shall I do the PA?" "I'll do it myself," Jim said, grabbing the mic. "That's my crowd back there, and I know what they like." So he cleared his throat loudly, and he said right off the bat, "Ladies and gentlemen, what are you at?" "We'll be passing by Ottawa, and we'll pass Montreal. I'm not fussy about either, so what odds at all?" Then it's off across the Gulf and on over Cape Ray, by Fox Roots, Burnt Islands, Rose Blanche, and Canora Bay, by Grand Britain, Burgio, Franceway, and McCallum, by Hermitage and Galtus and Boxey and Ballorum, over Bay Largent and Dunscope, Haystack and Dildo, and over Hope Isle and Riverhead, where the coil is, you know. Then it's over the bay and then over Baleen for a landing, I dare say, on runway 16. Then he forgot about the mic and said after a while, "Nowden, I'm starving. Where's my bottle of swill?" Right away there arose a great noise in the back. "I jump," said Jim. "That's the crowd from Fort Mac." "Sit down and be quiet," he let out the bar. "I got 19 bottles, enough for us all." A short while later, the smell of the seal was all through the plane as the boys had their meal. One welder from Chance Cove said to the young maid, "Any chance the skipper got a bit of hard braid?" As they dodged along nicely at 35,000, Jim said, "I should check my slips today, I allows," and right off Port of Bass, he took her down low to see if he could see any turs on the go. He could see that the waters weren't very turry as he waved to the skipper on the Port of Bass ferry. "He's a buddy of mine," he said to young Tim. "Yes, Captain, but shouldn't we be hiring him?" Finishing his bottle of flipper and liver, Jim turned left and flew up the Baden Nord River. "But Captain," said Tim, "won't we be late?" "A little," said Jim, "but the crowd home will wait." As they flew up the river at about treetop height, Jim said, "Lots of rabbits around, not a partridge in sight. But look at that moose stood up there so proud. I got to mark that one on the map for the Turnip Cove crowd." As they dodged around Mount Peyton, something powerful and sleek passed on the left, just a pure yellow streak. "It's a UFO," said Tim. "I'm sure. Yes, I am." "That's the wife's father," said Jim, "on his old 12 Elan." Then a voice came on the radio. "Want to stop and boil up? I got some roast capelin and saltwater duck." "Not today, boy," said Jim. "I just had some swill. I think we'll go out to Fogo and watch hockey for a while." A short while later, they were holding at Tilting, where the game was unfolding and Tilting was wilting. Jim called a play for the crowd in the back. "I know now, young Petty, never give young Billy some crack." With the score 6-1, Tilting had no escape. Jim said, "Let's fly to Bonavista and go around the Cape. Young Ryder's aboard, and I dare say he'd rather take a dodge by his house and wave to his mother." "But Captain," said Tim, "I can't really see how we'll make it to St. John's. We're low on fuel now." "Don't worry," said Jim. "I won't put us in peril. Look, there's Mrs. Ryder and Mayor Fitzgerald." "Who wants a coffee?" Jim said on the PA as they flew down the north side of Trinity Bay. No one seemed to mind when the first place they arrived to wasn't town, but the Clarenville Tim Hortons drive-thru. 8 dozen honey glaze, Jim put in his order. And one of those nice cakes with hearts around the border. It's the wife's birthday cake, and she likes one in yellow. And a punch and a coffee, decaf for the young fellow. Now, when all hands had their order and were comfortably sat, Jim took off again from the mall parking lot. "Captain, my captain," young Timothy said, "I'm not liking the math going on in my head. By my calculations, we won't reach Torbay. We'll run out of fuel before we're halfway." "Yes, buddy," said Jim. "Let's get Bessie a drink at the Gobies Big Stop. I got some coupons, I think." So they pitched down again and turned in by the Moose, filled her up with Supreme for a little more boost. Jim said, "I wants to down Homer for the puzzles and that." "What's a three-letter word for feline?" "Oh, yeah, cat." Airborne again, young Tim said, at last. But Jim said, no hurry now, we got thousands of gas. We'll trim along the shoreline for a nice little randy and land when we want to, because town's only handy. So they flew down to Cape Shore and around Cape St. Mary's over Branch, where Jim said, that's some spot for berries. Over St. Mary's Bay and then over Cape Friels. Nobody said, Jim, you like the jigs best or reels? Well, Tim had no idea what the captain was saying and whether he should smile and nod or maybe start praying. Jim said, we got a bit of time before we gets moored again. And with that, he produced a small button accordion. Lay ho, William Mulford, lay ho, William White. Well, Jim played it all wrong and he never sang right. And then he got all overcome and started to bow. Poor kitty, he said, how stunned was Buddy at all? Heaving a sigh, Jim put down the box and said, now here's where the floors all went on the rocks. We'll take a dart in land when we get to Fermuse and check on my cabin in back of Renews. A short while later, as they crossed Witless Bay, Jim said, he suppose that he'd land now and call it a day. Call up the tower, he said, and get me the weather till I puts on my specs so I can see better. Windy, said the tower, and a little bit dunch. I can still see my nose, but I can't see my lunch. And watch out for small cars and flying tree trunks and Belle Island blew away somewhere out around the funks. We should divert, said Tim, his voice starting to croak. Some chance now, said Jim, I got fish in the soap. But I'll put the boots to her, he told the young lad, and get on the ground now before it gets bad. Well, they started to bounce and started to dip. Had to go hard to starboard, round an oil rig ship. Nobody, said Jim, as he dodged round a log. What's a three-letter word for canine? Oh, yeah, dog. When they finally touched down with a bit of a flop and taxied to the gate and came to a stop, Tim wiped the sweat off his brow with a hanky. I got no punt like this one, Jim said. She's right cranky. As the people got off the air filled with the sound of CFAs bawling and kissing the ground, he's a hero, said one, to land in this mess. Not bad for a Tony, said a bayman, I guess. So Jim's still flying planes, and one day last year, just after eating a bottle of tur, he told a plane load of people, there'll be a delay. The Capelin is in down the Great Bear's Way. Thank you.